Hello everyone, welcome to MBBS classes. Myself Dr. Hanifa. Today in this video I'll be talking on auditory brainstem response, which in short is sometimes called as ABR, or it is also known as BERA. The full form of BERA is brainstem evoked response audiometry. This ABR, it is an auditory evoked potential or the response that occurs in the first 10 milliseconds after an auditory stimulus. So there are multiple auditory evoked responses which can be recorded from the brain, and ABR is one of them. And the site of origin of this auditory stimulus induced potential is the brainstem. That's why this ABR is called as auditory brainstem response. This auditory brainstem response, or ABR, it is a far-field recording of the synchronized response of numerous neurons in the auditory pathway that are located within the brainstem. This ABR was first described in the year 1967 by Sohmer and Fensmer. But remember, this ABR, it is not a hearing test. So today's topic is on the ABR, and ABR, it is one of the auditory evoked potential. So these auditory evoked potentials, they refer basically to all the auditory evoked responses from the brain, and they may be classified on the basis of latency. In the first column you can see they may be classified on the basis of anatomical site of generation and on the basis of distance between the site of generation and the recording site. So now let's see how these auditory evoked potentials are classified on the basis of latency. They may be early response or short response when the responses occur within 10 to 15 milliseconds after a stimulus presentation. The example of this early response is electrocochleography and ABR. Then it may be a middle latency response when we get the response or the waveforms after a duration of 10 to 50 milliseconds. Then the third type of response from the brain following an auditory stimulus can be a long response or the late latency response that occurs beyond 50 to 80 milliseconds. When these auditory evoked potentials are divided or classified on the basis of anatomical site of generation, they are divided into four groups. The first is the cochlear response, and under this cochlear response, it is included the cochlear microphonics and the summiting potentials. The next comes the auditory nerve responses. The example is the electrocochleography. The third AEP arising from the brainstem is the brainstem response, and the fourth one is the responses originating from the cortex. So the auditory brainstem response, which is our today's class, it is an early response because it is recorded within the first 10 milliseconds after the auditory stimulus. Since it is a brainstem response, it originates from the brainstem area. Now whenever a stimulus is given, then on the basis of the site of the electrodes, the auditory evoked potentials, they can be divided into near field response and far field response. So what is this near field response? The near field response, by saying so, we mean that the recording electrode is on the site which is very close to the site of generation. Let's take an example in electrocochleography. When the recording electrode is placed in a over the promontory through the transtympanic route. And the another example of near field response is whenever this auditory evoked potentials are used in the intraoperative period. Then ABR, we have seen that it is a far field response because the recording electrodes are placed far away from the site of origin and they are usually placed on the scalp. So our today's class, that is the ABR, it is an early response. It is a brainstem response and it is a far field response. Now let's see where these ABRs are used. Primarily, it was used for the evaluation of suspected 8th cranial nerve or the brainstem lesions. And this was mostly used around 2 decades ago when the radiographic imaging like CT and MRI was not widely available. That time, the ABR played a vital role in evaluating the cases of the 8th and the brainstem lesions. Now, ABR sometimes is also used for the estimation of hearing thresholds in newborns and infants. In cases of in the previous era when the radiographic facility was not widely available, then the based on the findings of the ABR waveforms, finding the interpeak latencies, the lesions used to be categorized. Let's take an example. If there was delay between the wave 1 and wave 3, it used to suggest the lesions between the 8th nerve and the lower pons. So like this, the interpeak latency can help us to detect the site of origin of the lesion. So we have seen the uses. It is used to detect the lesions in the cranial nerve 8 and the brainstem. It is used for determining the hearing thresholds. Now, if I ask you a question, what does this ABR test? So the answer is very simple. It assesses the neural response integrity and the synchrony. What happens? We know that it is an auditory evoked potential to a stimulus. So whenever the neural responses is prompt, and when we get the waveforms, then the synchronous neural response, they tell us that both the peripheral and the central nervous system is responding. And moreover, there is a simultaneous firing of the multiple neurons. So by this way, if we get a good waveforms in the ABR, we know that we can know about the integrity and the synchrony of the neural system. Then second is, it gives the estimate of the hearing thresholds. Now our question is, how the ABR helps us to assess the hearing thresholds? For this, what is done is, the stimuli, that is the auditory stimulus, it is presented at various intensity level. So when the stimulus is presented above and below the thresholds, it is going to generate the auditory evoked potentials. So when we get these potentials, they appear like these waveforms. So here you can see that in the horizontal axis, it is written milliseconds, that is, it gives us the time where we get the respective waveforms. And this is dB/NHL. It gives about the intensity of the stimulus. So whenever we are giving any stimulus at any particular intensity, we try to find out the lowest stimulus intensity which will yield the neural response. And the most responsible waveform which is used in identifying the threshold is the wave 5. So there are 5 wave forms in a adult ABR which is by a click stimuli. So we'll see what are the different types of stimulus. So here you can see that the waveforms, this is the waveform 1, waveform 3 and the 5. Here you can see that the intensity level used is the starting level is 90 decibel. So what we try to find out is the lowest intensity level till where we can see the wave 5. So here the lower intensity level where we can see the wave 5 is the 30 dB/NHL. And then this is how we assess the thresholds of the hearing. So when it is used, we know that ABR, it is not a hearing test. So when to be used in assessing the auditory functions, because this cannot be a replacement for a Pureton audiometry or a behavior audiometry. Remember, It is useful in those infants, children, and adults who cannot participate in behavioral audiometry. The advantage is that it is the non-invasive procedure and it is an objective method of assessment, and moreover, it is not affected by the patient's attention, sleep, or sedation status. Then it is used in newborns who do not pass newborn hearing screening, and to know the sensitivity of hearing in each ear and to assess the sensitivity in various frequencies. So these are the conditions where when we can make a maximum use of the ABR in determining the hearing thresholds and in assessing the auditory functions. So here you can see that this is an BERA in an infant with the hearing loss. So we'll see the normal waveform later on, but let me just tell you that here the recording is started at a maximum intensity of 85 dB NHL. So here you can see that we are getting a wave 1 and the wave 5. And the last wave, prominent wave 5, we are getting at 75. That is, the hearing threshold is too high. So this is how a BERA can help us in determining and identifying the infants with the hearing loss. Now let us come to a little bit technical part of the recordings. So these ABRs, they are recorded using the differential amplification, and we use the EEG electrodes. So the differential amplification is that when we are recording the waveforms by electrodes, the other electrical activity which is generated in the brain is eliminated by the process called the differential amplification, and we get the recordings only of the auditory pathway up to the brainstem. So for the recording, we need electrodes, and ABR, it is a far field recording. That means it is recorded far away from the site of origin of the waveforms. So there are three types of electrodes which are used. The first is called the non-inverting, or you can say active, or the positive electrodes, and it is positioned at the vertex or the high forehead of the patient. Then second type of electrode is the inverting or the reference electrodes. They are also called as the negative electrodes, and they might be positioned at the mastoid, earlobes, and sometimes at the nape of the neck also. Then third electrode is the ground electrode. It is also called as the neutral or the common electrode, and which is placed most commonly on the cheek of the patient. Now coming to the stimulus. So we know that the ABR, it is a auditory evoked potential following an auditory stimulus. So there are two type of stimulus. The first is the broadband stimulus. The example is the clicks. And the second stimulus is the frequency specific stimuli, which is tone burst, tone pips, or the filtered clicks. But whenever, in general, when we are talking about the ABR, we mean that these are click induced ABRs. And these click induced ABRs, they give a very classical ABR morphology, and because we have good data, normative data to compare our patient results, so the broadband stimuli, that is the clicks, are most commonly used for recording the ABR waveforms. But there is one disadvantage of broadband stimuli. It is that since these are broadband in nature, it stimulates the more basal regions of the cochlea, and it is not possible to assess the exact frequency range of hearing loss which is involved. But that is possible when we use a frequency specific stimulus. When we use it, we can know that which frequency range of the hearing is affected. Now let us see about the type of waveforms in an adult ABR. In a normal hearing adults, the click induced ABRs, it consists of series of vertex positive peaks. These are also called as waves, and that occur in the first 10 milliseconds after an auditory stimulus. These waves are traditionally labeled in the Roman numerals from 1 to 5. And the respective waves from 1 to 5, they reflect the neural activity from the level of auditory system up to the inferior colliculus. The wave 1, it reflects the activity of the auditory nerve. Wave 2, it reflects the activity of the cochlear nucleus. The wave 3, superior olivary nucleus. The waveform, it reflects the activity of lateral lemniscus. And wave 5, inferior colliculus. Before we go on to a reading of the normal ABR, just remember that the wave 1 in a click induced ABR, it occurs at approximately a latency of 1.5 milliseconds, and the subsequent peaks, they occur at an interval of 1 milliseconds. That means after a click induced stimulus, the wave 5 is recorded at approximately 5 to 6 milliseconds after the onset of stimulus. Now, this is a ABR of a normal hearing adult using the click stimulus. So here you can see that it is written click, that is a stimulus type. You can see in this data, the stimulus rate is also mentioned, that is 31. That means 31 click rates per seconds. Then polarity is written rarefaction. And here you can see that for finding out the thresholds, the intensity is started from the 90 dB NHL. And whenever we are reading an ABR, the most dependable waves are, these are the three waves. First is the wave 1, wave 3, and the wave 5. So while we are reading, we have to look for these three waves, plus we have to find out the interpeak latency, like the interpeak latency between 1 and 3, 1 and 5, and 3 and 5, because these interpeak latencies, they tell us about the time taken for the stimulus from the auditory nerve to the brainstem. This 1 to 5 interwave latency is also called as brainstem transmission latency, and it is very much important indicator of retrocochlear pathology. In a case of a normal adult, whenever the stimulus is given at the highest intensity, we get all the waves. That means from wave 1 to 5. And here you can see that this is the wave 1. And as the intensity is reduced, you will see that the latency of the wave 5, it keeps on increasing. This one we can find out. So if you see here, the intensity at the highest level, 90 dB NHL, is of wave 5 is 5.5 milliseconds. It is approximately normal. In a normal hearing adult, the wave 5 we get at a latency of 5 to 6 milliseconds. Now, as we are reducing the intensity, you can see that at around 40 dB NHL, we are getting, there is a increase in the latency of the wave 5. So this is normal. As the intensity of the stimulus reduces, the latency of the wave 5 increases. Then while we are reading, we have to see the interpeak latency. In a adult and in children more than 18 months of age, these interpeak latency between 1 and 5, they should not exceed 4.5 milliseconds. And in infants below 18 months of age, these interpeak latency between 1 and 5 should not exceed more than 5.5 milliseconds. So these things we have to see while reading an ABR. So we know that the morphology of the ABR waveforms is different in adults and is different in children less than 18 months of age. The reason is it happens due to the ongoing neural maturation of process after the birth and continuing myelination of the auditory pathway after the birth. Remember one thing, the waveforms, they vary between premature and the term infant also. So we must know how a waveforms in an infant, term infant looks like. Then only we'll be able to find out the abnormal wave ABR morphology. And to tell that this particular waveform is abnormal, always consider the patient factors, especially the age of the patient. In infants, the most visible waveforms are wave 1, wave 3, and wave 5. But remember one thing, in cases of infants and the young children, the latency of wave 1, 3, and 5 is prolonged in comparison to the adults. Moreover, the wave 5 latency is prolonged at around 7 milliseconds. So here you can see that the waveform 5 is at around 7 milliseconds, and sometimes the wave 1 may also be prolonged. It is not only the latency which is longer in case of young children, it is also the amplitude which also changes with the age. In cases of adults, the amplitude of wave 5 is higher. So if and whereas in cases of infants, the amplitude of wave 1 and wave 3 may be greater than the wave 5. So what happens when we are reading? We look into the different waveforms. We see the latency, interpeak latencies also, and we also try to see the amplitude of the wave. The amplitude of the wave is measured from the peak to the following trough. And in cases of adults, the amplitude ratio of wave 5 and the wave 1 is always more than 1. So whenever it is less than 1 in case of adults, it means it is suggestive of some retrocochlear pathology. So we have seen the relationship of ABR with the age, but the ABR waveforms also vary with the different stimulus characteristics. So always while reading the ABR, take into account the stimulus intensity, stimulus frequency, stimulus rate, and the stimulus polarity. We'll come to one by one. Now first is the stimulus intensity. A lot depends on the stimulus intensity while reading a BERA. So we must take into account whenever we are reading. So we have seen that as the stimulus intensity reduces, the latency of the wave increases. So what is latency? It is the post-stimulus time at which the wave peaks occurs, these waveforms. So if we see the latency of the wave one latency at 90 dB NHL is 1.5 milliseconds. But as the intensity is reducing, the latency is increasing. So here you can see that the latency, it increases. And as the latency, it is reduced, the wave 2 and wave 1, they are first to disappear. And the most consistent, reliable waveform we always look for is the wave 5. So this, when we see the wave 5 and we try to find out till what intensity level the wave 5 can be seen, and this will determine our threshold. Then another factor related to stimulus is the stimulus frequency, which also affects the morphology of the waves in ABR. It is seen that whenever we are giving a lower frequency stimulus, the latency of the wave 5 is prolonged. The reason is for the lower frequency waves. So we know that the basal regions, they correlate with the high frequency sounds, and the apex, it correlates with the low frequency sounds. So when we are presenting a lower frequency stimulus, the wave has to travel a long distance up to the apex, so the latency of the wave 5 will be definitely prolonged. Whenever we are giving a higher frequency stimulus, then it stimulates the neurons of the basal region of the cochlea, and we get a robust response within a short duration of time, so we get a shorter ABR latencies. Then next important factor is the stimulus rate. So stimulus rate is particularly important when we are reading the ABR in infants and young children. It is seen that faster the rate increases the latencies. Now for clinical applications, generally the rate is selected between 11.1 seconds to 71.1 seconds. And for clinical purpose, generally a rate of 11.1, 31 or 21 stimulus rate per second is generally used. Here you can say we have used 31 per second. So whenever we are giving a faster rate of stimuli, what happens? It increases the latency and there will be decrease in the amplitude of the waveforms. So this is how the waveforms, they change a lot with the age. The waveforms, they change with the different stimulus factors. So with this, I come to an end of this video, and I hope you have understood about the basics of the ABR, its uses, various factors which you must consider while interpreting the waveform. With this, thank you for watching MBBS classes.